streaming as well. Okay. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Thank you for joining on this, joining us in this Ramadan reflection. I'm your brother in faith, Shabir Ali. Tonight, we're discussing Surah Al-Fath. It is the 40th chapter of the Quran. It is called Surah Al-Fath, which means the opening, or it also means the victory. I'll explain the meaning and the connection between these two terms in an Islamic context. This surah follows very closely from the previous one, the 47th chapter, which we discussed last night, which was Surah Muhammad. In Surah Muhammad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet is being told how to recognize the hypocrites by their signs. And in this surah, the signs of the believers, on the other hand, are mentioned. So the signs of the believers, you will see them, tarahum ruk'an sujadan, you will see them performing ruku and sujood. And the signs of their frequent prostration is there on their foreheads. We know nowadays we are praying on soft carpets, but in those days they prayed on the harsh ground. And so it left a mark on the forehead due to frequent prostration. That was the mark of the believers. Of course, the mark is not only on one's face, but also in one's willingness to continue with the call of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to follow his dictates and proceed along with him despite the dangers that the Muslims faced. We've already seen from the previous surah the kinds of dangers that they faced from within and from without. Now, after the Battle of Al-Ahzab, I don't know why we call it the Battle of Ahzab, because there was no battle. Remember, the Prophet, peace be upon him, dug a ditch to stave off the enemy advances, and that protected the city until the enemy dissipated. So there was no fight. Except for some skirmishes, but the two armies did not actually engage with each other. So there was no real battle. After that, the Muslims felt empowered. They felt that the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them, so that this large contingent of Confederate forces could not overcome them and wipe out their city. And so they made bold to go and perform the pilgrimage along with the Prophet, peace be upon him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the call, 1,400 persons responded. So they went along with the Prophet, peace be upon him. They got close to Mecca, but before they could enter, the non-Muslims blocked them from entering. And so they didn't know what to do. They sent Uthman radiallahu an to let the leaders of the opposition know that the Muslims are here for good purposes, not for any fight, but only for the peaceful purpose of performing the Umrah. But nonetheless, they were prohibited. And the Muslims thought that Uthman radiallahu an, their envoy, may have been seized and killed for the length of time that he had been away, and they were anxious about his return. So then it seemed as if they might have to go to war to just avenge the death of Uthman radiallahu an. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, took a pledge from these 1,400 companions that they will do whatever it takes and they will stand their ground in battle, though they were only few in number. And this is known as Baitul Ridwan, the pledge of the pleasure. And why is it called a pleasure? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah was pleased with the Muslims when they took the pledge with the Prophet, peace be upon him, under that tree. So that's known as the pledge of the pleasure, meaning the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the companions who are known to have participated in that pledge naturally deserved recognition among the Muslims, and they received that. Moreover, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when the believers place their hands into the hand of the Prophet, peace be upon him, to take the pledge, that the hand of Allah, yadullahi fawqa aydihim, the hand of Allah was above their hands. And that shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was very pleased with them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was taking their pact with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as though they were making a pact with Allah. And so we see from this incident, and there are many other verses of the Quran and so on that corroborate this, that obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the ground was taken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as obedience to him, because this was the envoy from Allah, this is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what he commands is being commanded on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and obedience to him was indirectly obedience to Allah as well. So the believers definitely were being tested in all of these different situations, and we are pleased and we are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has accepted us as Muslims without putting us through such hard tests. I'm watching my time, that's why I put my glasses on, so that I don't take much longer with this discourse. Now, as a result of all of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised victory to the Muslims. So I said I'll explain the word fath. Fath means victory, but it also means opening. In fact, literally it means opening, from the verb in Arabic fataha, which means he opened, yaftahu, he opens. Al-fath is the masdar or the verbal noun, which means the opening. In Islamic terms, the opening of a place means that that place now becomes free for Muslims to practice their faith therein. And of course, by extension, Muslims will allow non-Muslims to practice their faith as well. Whereas in the ancient world, largely the situation was one of religious intolerance. And the Muslims themselves were feeling the brunt of that intolerance, because they and their religion was not being tolerated in the hometown of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet had to migrate away in order to be able to safely practice his religion, he and his followers. Now, as they were going back into Mecca to perform the Umrah, they are being blocked. Now, we are all feeling the strain of being blocked due to the coronavirus, but imagine if there was an enemy on the ground who is preventing Muslims from entering Mecca. Muslims would be very furious, and many would see that as a reason for going to war with the enemy. Here, the Prophet ﷺ made a pact with them that they will return. They won't perform the Umrah that year, but they will perform it the next year. That means they have to come back. The non-Muslims stipulated other conditions for a treaty. They said that if any of the Quraysh people should join the Muslims, therefore by becoming Muslims, then the Muslims would have to return those persons. They would not be allowed to stay among the Muslims. Whereas on the other hand, if any of the Muslims were to go and join the Quraysh people, then that Muslim will be kept by them. So you can see it was a one-sided sort of stipulation, but the Prophet, peace be upon him, accepted that, and there was a truce now for 10 years of peace, so that nobody would attack the other, and also the allies of each other would be safe from the other side. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to this treaty as a victory, according to many commentators on the Quran, which is a very interesting thing, because usually the victory is a reference to like the result of a battle. You have a battle and then one side is victorious, the other one is a failure. But here the victory is a reference to the actual signing of a truce, a peace agreement. Now, the commentators of the Quran, like Ibn Kathir, say that there were 17 years of the preaching of Islam before this treaty was signed. And then there were 17 months after this treaty, while it was in place, before the non-Muslims broke the treaty. So in that those 17 months, while the treaty was in force, more people entered Islam than in the 17 years prior to the treaty. And what that proved was that the treaty itself was a victory for the Muslims. So the victory for the Muslims was not in battle, but in peace. And how did that happen? It so happens that when there are hostile forces meeting, nobody is in the mood to stop and listen to what the other side has to say, whether good or bad. But when the peace treaty was in place and everyone felt safe, that is when the non-Muslims started to interact with the Muslims, on a friendly basis, or at least in a non-threatening manner, not feeling the threat from Muslims, and they were willing to listen to what the Muslims had to say, and they were willing to learn something about the new religion. Abu Sufyan himself had come to visit Medina, and though he was the arch enemy of Islam, the leader of the opposition and the enemies, his daughter got married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Habiba. She had embraced Islam and she came to Medina and married the Prophet, peace be upon him. In fact, she had first migrated to Abyssinia, but her husband died there, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, married her from the distance, and then she came to live with the Prophet, peace be upon him, in Medina. When Abu Sufyan, her father, now representing the enemy, came to visit her, she gave him a treatment which registered for him the intensity of her faith and her belief in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he went back to his people, he went back a different person. He went back with that impression about Islam and Muslims, especially the impression he got from his daughter. And that paved the way for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to march into Mecca and take it over without needing to fight and to defeat the enemy, because Abu Sufyan, the leader of the opposition, had made some preparations for that, to make this a peaceful entry, and of course, as it results, a victory for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims, a victory given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this surah is very interesting in that it calls itself, it begins by saying, "Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina," we have granted you the clear victory. And so the surah comes to be called Suratul Fath, the surah of the victory. But technically, the word Fath means opening, and that refers to the opening of this territory for the preaching and the practice of Islam. So whereas Mecca was previously closed off to Muslims and Islam, now it is open. And that is a victory that the very peace treaty was the victory which then opened the way further for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come back in 2 years later and to take over the entire town. So this treaty was signed in the sixth year of the Hijrah, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, came back, and what is referred to now as the opening of Mecca was done in the eighth year. So altogether, what we learn from this surah is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the Muslims, and he will make sure that one way or another, his religion and his message comes to be heard. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a nutshell, هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. Allah has revealed the religion of truth and the guidance to his prophet, and he will make sure that it overcomes all other systems, and he is enough as a witness to that. So Surah Al-Fath, the surah of the victory or the opening. That is my humble discussion on the 40th chapter of the Quran. Thank you all for joining me in this Ramadan reflection tonight. Peace be with you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.